there's some properties that we could talk about for this system. The Lorenz equations. The equations are actually symmetric, and that's significant. They're symmetric under if you have x and y go to negative x, negative y. And hopefully you could see that in the first equation, right? If we just substitute negative x for x and negative y, for all these, we'll get negative x dot equals sigma negative y plus x. And it ends up being the same. So the first equation doesn't change. What about the second one? Negative y dot equals negative rx, negative negative y, and then negative negative x, z. Just divide by negative one, and you'll get that that doesn't change. We're not changing z. Z still stays z. And then z dot doesn't change, but because we've got negative x times negative y, and then something that's just a function of z, well, then this doesn't change. What does this mean? Anytime you have equations that are symmetric like this, it means if x, y, and z as a function of time, if that is a solution, then negative x, negative y, and z is also a solution. So it's like for every solution, x, y, and z, there's sort of this mirror image solution, negative x, negative y, and z. They could be the same if x and y are both zero or something, but that's something to notice. And when we have symmetry like this, if you remember the bead in the rotating hoop, we had this symmetry, left-right symmetry, because we were exactly rotating about the middle. Not deviated, but right the middle. If you remember what kind of bifurcation we got with that as we tuned a parameter, we got a pitchfork bifurcation. So when you have symmetries, you'll tend to get a pitchfork bifurcation. So we may have something like that in this system as well. So that's one thing to notice. The other thing, and we'll have to say quite a bit about this one, is that the system is dissipative. That the system is dissipative. And you may have heard this term to mean that something that loses energy with time, like if you add damping, if you come from a mechanics background, you think of, oh, if I add damping or friction, then my system is dissipating energy. But we mean dissipative in another sense. There's a relationship between the two senses, but this is in the sense that volumes in phase space contract over time. So what does that mean? We did say a little bit about this when we talked about Hamiltonian systems in 2D, that the 2D volume, meaning area, did not change with time. So we're going to go into more detail about that, but in this 3D setting, which actually extends to n dimensions, but in this 3D setting. So the way to think of it is to think of a kind of an arbitrary potato-shaped region of phase space. So here's some kind of arbitrary shape. That's not terribly arbitrary. But if you look at me, look, here's an actual potato. I grabbed a potato. I want you to think not like a sphere. You could say, okay, how does a sphere change its volume? I want you to think of arbitrary blobs, 3D blobs of phase space, much like this potato. So if we take some points inside here and they will contract over time, meaning contracting, you know, under the flow. So this blob will change. I don't know how it will change. It'll become, I'm kind of trying to make it more arbitrary looking. For any points inside this blob, they'll map to other points. And we want to know what happens to the volumes. So if here's the volume at time t, if you actually take the volume, how do volumes evolve? All that really matters is the points on the surface of the volume. So we're going to consider points on the surface and how they flow according to the vector field. So we're probably going to have to do some 3D vector calculus. it's useful at this point to think of the phase space as a fluid and to use some ideas from fluid mechanics. We'll write positions as x with a line under it, so we know that means vector position. And then there'll be u, the fluid velocity vector. So this is the velocity in phase space, not physical space, phase space. If we were to take a little patch of a surface and it's got a unit normal, if we want to know how that surface, how that little patch moves, we would take u dotted with n. And maybe I'll write n instead of my hat notation, my n bar. So n is a unit vector that just describes the normal of a patch of surface on this volume. If the volume is V, some notation that's used is we write this thing that looks like the partial, but it means the boundary of V. So this is a patch of surface, you know, on the boundary of V. So this means X dot dotted with N. So the components of this velocity and phase space are these components, right, from the Lorenz equations themselves. So with that, what will this be? This will be, if we write the, you know, velocity, some arbitrary velocity. This is the normal outward velocity you kind of project onto here. It says, how is that boundary, how's that patch of the boundary moving? So let me draw a picture. We've got our weird shape, arbitrary shape here. Draw something that looks more like a squash. We don't have a squash in the kitchen right now, but if you take a little patch, right, here's some little patch, and we've got a normal to that patch. And then we've got the fluid velocity. That's, we'll also use u, just like with a fluid flow. The boundary of this thing is, I'll write it as partial v. So this is the volume. And we've got a boundary. We want to know what happens after some short amount of time. So if this is the volume at time t, what is the volume at time t plus a small delta t? I don't know how this is going to move. It's going to move to, maybe I'll draw in a different color, slightly different. Right, the whole volume may move. And then this might, you know, go to something else. So what is that volume? How is it changing? So we could write that write it this way, V of T plus delta T. That's what maybe careful what I mean by the outer boundary here, because now this is like the outer boundary at T plus delta T. The outer boundary of just T. We're looking at delta T is very small. So this will be the volume at time T plus the volume swept out by tiny patches of surface integrated over all the patches. So if we were to focus on what is that patch, so we're just sort of zooming in on that little patch. We'll have a little piece of the surface. This has an area, a small differentiable area that we'll be integrating over later, dA. And what's that thickness? So the change, this is u dotted with n times delta t. Right, that will be the volume of the tiny patch. We could write the outward normal here. So we could write what the volume is of that tiny patch, roughly equal to u dotted with n delta t, right? The thickness times dA. And now we can integrate. So v at t plus delta t equals v at t volume at t, plus we want to integrate over the volumes. But we're integrating over little patches. So what we really want to do is we're doing a, if you want, a double integral over the boundary, u dotted with n delta t, and then we're integrating over these little patches dA all over the place. The delta t can be brought out because it's not part of the integral. I guess I could put approximate. This actually becomes equal if we look at the limit. So let's think about that. Let's take the limit as delta t goes to zero. And what do we have there? So the limit as delta t goes to zero. And let's rearrange this. So we've got vt plus delta t minus v of t divided by delta t. And maybe you recognize what that is. This is the definition of the derivative. So this is v dot at time t. And what are we left with when we do that? It is this double integral over the boundary u dotted with n dA. And now we use a result from vector calculus, right? We use the divergence theorem. So we know that this is equal to the triple integral over the volume of the divergence of the velocity field. And now we're integrating over the entire volume. So little dv, little cubes of volume everywhere, rather than little patches of surface. So this is by the divergence theorem. So you notice we get the divergence. So we use the divergence when we talked about Hamiltonian systems, but we were looking at just divergence in 2D. Now we've got divergence in 3D for a system that we don't even know if it has any kind of structure. What do we do? Let me just repeat the Lorenz equations and then take the divergence of them. All right, x dot equals sigma y minus x, y dot equals rx minus y minus xz, z dot equals xy minus bz. And the divergence of that fluid flow, right, this is, that's the flow vector. We could write this as it's partial x dot partial x plus partial y dot partial y plus partial z dot partial z. And then just calculate it out. What is partial x dot partial x? This is negative sigma. Okay, partial y dot partial y, negative one. Partial z dot partial z minus b. So this is cool. It's sigma, I'll write it this way, sigma plus b plus one. Sigma and b are positive. So negative of all that is less than zero. So it's interesting that it's constant. Right, we have that the divergence is negative and constant, which means what? Well, let's plug this back in to what we have for the formula. We have v dot equals this divergence, which because it's constant, we could pull it out of the integral. And then we just have a triple integral over the volume, which is just the volume. So here we have negative sigma plus b plus one. V. And this is just a one-dimensional ODE with a constant coefficient. So it could be integrated. V as a function of time is whatever V is initially times e to the negative sigma plus b plus 1t. So this is what we mean by dissipative. In fact, volumes are not only shrinking, they are shrinking exponentially fast. We should specify phase space, right? These are phase space volumes. We're only working in phase space. Phase space volumes shrink exponentially fast. What does this mean? What does it mean? If volumes are shrinking exponentially fast, you start with any volume of initial conditions. The potato volume will shrink which just means it's exponentially fast going to something of zero volume, zero 3D volume. So the upshot is that all trajectories eventually tend to some limit set of zero volume. Take T goes to infinity, zero volume. What this doesn't tell us is that things are uniformly shrinking. So it's not that the potato is uniformly shrinking. It could be shrinking in some directions and growing in others, and overall the volume is getting low. And what would happen in that case, if it's sort of growing in two directions but shrinking in one, you would shrink to something that's, you know, flat, some kind of 2D shape. I don't know if I have a 2D shape or I have a coaster. It's 2D. That's one possibility. It could go to a one-dimensional object, like a periodic orbit. That has no volume because it's just a curve. Curves in 3D have no volume. They're just curves. Could be a point. So this limit set, it could be a point, a limit cycle, right? Because that's 1D. Points are 0D. Or some 2D set. So the strategy that we can use to sort of to show what the possibilities are, and it will depend on the parameters. For some value of the parameters, the limit set will be a point. For the interesting value of the parameters, it goes to this 2D set, which is, I've called it above, a chaotic attractor. It's also called strange because it's strange. So the limit set in this case means attractor. What kind of attractor is it? Is it a point? Perhaps it's one of two different points. Perhaps it's a limit cycle or something else. So if you could rule out that it's a point and rule out that it's a limit cycle, then you're sort of following what Sherlock Holmes said once, which is that when you have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. So you could be left with the only possibility, which is that, this settles onto some two-dimensional set. And what is that? That's that strange attractor that we see.